ask you a question, and that is, what is in your life's blueprint? Number one in your life's blueprint should be a deep belief in your own dignity, your own worth, and your own somebodiness.
We were chosen as the most likely not to succeed from where we came from, but it all starts with you. Believe in yourself.
Whatever the mess is in your life, young people and old people, take that mess, push it away, and become the message.
For the only way that dreams come alive and things we care about find their way into the mainstream is when we in communities all across this great nation work to make our own community a better, safer, and more wonderful place to live.
Always feel that you count. Always feel that you have worth. And always feel that your life has ultimate significance.
We have always pushed forward, and after some of our darkest hours, have come some of our biggest triumphs.
This city has a future, and its future is bright, and I know Detroit is going to come back stronger because you are resilient.
There's gonna be ups and downs along the way. There's going to be bumps in the road. That's a part of it. But don't let that distract you. Don't let that keep you from your dream.
But if you don't want something better for yourself, there is nothing I can tell you to get you to that point. You have to want something better. You have to be your own best mentor. Nobody else is gonna drag you there. You have to drag yourself.
All change is always done by the youth. And with all the turmoil that's going on in the world, I'm actually starting to see youth come out and take charge. And it makes me feel so, so good.
What do I see that the world needs for me to feel right in it? And then to think I can fill that gap.
If you can't fly, run. If you can't run, walk. If you can't walk, crawl, but by all means, keep moving.
Please stand for the national anthem performed by Chiara Clayton.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave?
Please remain standing for the Black National Anthem, performed by the Detroit Academy of Arts and Sciences Show Choir, under the direction of Angela Key.
Written over 100 years ago. It was composed by Mr. James Weldon Johnson. It is also known as the Black National Anthem. It brings hope and inspiration to everyone. Happy Martin Luther King Jr. Day from the Detroit Academy of Arts and Sciences.
You may be seated. Patrick Lindsay, Vice President of Government and Community Affairs, Wayne State University.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Glad to be here at another annual tribute to the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And not just glad to be here, but it's good to be back in person after 3-year hiatus. I was hoping to have the drumline come and bring me on to some music. But they were a bit engaged, so I figured I'd come out without music. But we'd like to welcome you here to our annual tribute program this year, presented to us by our partners at Amazon, and we're appreciative of them and all of our other sponsors as well. But this marks the 60th year anniversary of Dr. King's March on Washington. The full name of that event, if many of y'all may recall, was the March on Washington for Jobs and Justice and Freedom. It was on that day that Dr. King delivered his historic and iconic I Have a Dream speech. It was most remembered as a rallying cry for equality for all people, which it was, but it was also a call for economic equality and the right for gainful employment for all people, because you can't really have civil rights unless you have what John Bryan calls silver rights. The theme for today's program is economic freedom through social justice. And our keynote speaker, Randy D. Williams, who you will hear from momentarily, is the founder and president of Talley and Twine, the largest black-owned luxury watch company. He will illustrate how economic justice is just as important as social justice and central to Dr. King's message. Now, in addition to Randy Williams, our program is going to feature Wayne State current and students and alumni. We'll have recognition of phenomenal people who've made an impact in our community through our Arthur L. Johnson Community Leadership Awards. And we also will be having a special presentation today for our Legacy Award. But we'd like to certainly thank again not only Amazon, but Rocket for being a very strong supporter and sponsor of our program and of the Arthur L. Johnson Community Leadership Awards. But listen, in addition to thanking all of you for being here, I'd like to bring up the man at Wayne State University, our 12th president, M. Roy Wilson. Now, Dr. Wilson has supported this program since he's been here. His office has contributed to the financial support, but he himself supports this program not only by being here, but he has left a rich legacy in his tenure here at Wayne State, which we know will end in July of this year. But his legacy leaves this university in a great place. Here at Wayne State University, under his leadership, our graduation rates have steadily increased. In fact, we've seen Black graduation rates triple. And we've been acknowledged by the APLU, one of the nation's foremost advocacy groups on higher education, as best increased graduation rate in the nation 2 years. As a part of his legacy, there's been a plan to increase the diversity of Wayne State in terms of hiring a associate provost for diversity and inclusion, who I believe Marquita is here today, Dr. Chambly. She's with us, but it was under his leadership that that position was created. He created an Office of Multicultural Student Engagement to provide an inclusive environment for all of our students and staff and visitors, to promote awareness of initiatives that encourage academic excellence as well as other support for underrepresented and marginalized students, and that's important. $6 million was given to us by the Mellon Foundation so we could create a Detroit Center for Black Studies at Wayne State and increase our Black faculty by the number of 30. And that is significant when you think about it. Dr. Wilson has helped us to become one of the leading universities in the nation for social mobility, and we do it better than anyone else in the state of Michigan, all because we believe that this institution has not only an obligation and a duty, but it's our role to help create a pathway to economic freedom for all of our students, one of the best pathways to become in the economic mainstream is to get a college education. And Dr. Wilson's advocacy to include Pell students in our state formula just opens the door wider for support for all students to be able to get a college education. I could go on and on. He's getting mad at me right now. So I'm going to get out of the way and just let you hear from our 12th president, Dr. M. Roy Wilson.
Dr. M. Roy Wilson, 12th president, Wayne State University.
Well, thank you, Patrick. You know, I got here a little bit early, and one of the things you get to do when you get here early is take a picture with those talented young kids who were rehearsing. That's been the highlight of my week and maybe all of 2023 so far. You know, we gather here every year to celebrate the life and legacy of a man who forever altered the course of our nation with his radical dream of equality and love. Martin Luther King Jr.'s words ring immortal in American history. His dream speech galvanized a nation split by racism and injustice, and we often revisit his sermons and writings to remind ourselves of the rich wisdom they contain. But the Reverend King knew that words, even eloquent ones, were empty unless they stirred us to action. He said that life's most persistent and urgent question is, what are you doing for others? He was a man who did so much for others. Indeed, made the ultimate sacrifice for his ardent belief in equality and justice for all. And so to breathe life into his legacy today means honoring him not just with words, but with actions as well. At Wayne State University, we strive to answer that most persistent question through our mission of education and community impact. As do all of the honorees we're celebrating today's program, as I hope all of you in the audience to do also. Let's join together this morning in reflection on what the Reverend King did for others, what our honorees have done for others, and what more each of us can do for others. And through our collective efforts, we can make a tremendous stride forward on our journey down the sunlit path of racial justice. In step and keeping with the Reverend King's dream that America will someday be a land where all men and women are indeed equal. I want to thank all of the audience members for joining us for this special celebration today. And I especially want to thank members of our Board of Governors who are here. Vice Chair Shirley Stancato will be introducing them, so I won't introduce them, but thank you very much for being here. And I particularly want to thank also, because they don't get the recognition very often, but the people who are really responsible for putting on this program every year, year after year, led by Patrick Lindsay and Stacy Clayton. Now, Stacy is somewhere in the back there. Well, to all of you, sight unseen, many of you, thank you very much for doing this every year, and thank you all.
Shirley Stancato, Vice Chair, Wayne State University, Board of Governors.
Good morning. Now, some of you have heard me do this before, know that I was raised in the Baptist tradition, Reverend Peake. And in that tradition, I'm accustomed to call and response. So let's do that again. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good, I feel welcome now. Thank you. On behalf of the Board of Governors, I want to welcome you to Wayne State's Martin Luther King Jr. celebration. Now, today is a day for taking stock of both the progress we've made, as well as the struggles we still face in our battles with institutional racism, unequal treatment under law, disparities in health care, and other artifacts of the difference between our national values and our history. This holiday is about remembering Dr. King's life, his words, and his sacrifices. Everyone is familiar with the rhetorical masterpiece that he delivered at the Lincoln Memorial in Washington, D.C., which has been referenced already, in 1963. It's known as the I Have a Dream speech. Fewer people recall that Dr. King gave a version of that very speech 2 months earlier right here in Detroit. And while Dr. King is far more popular across all America today than he was during his lifetime, even now, we rarely remember him for his views on economic justice. As an urban research university, Wayne State is fully aware of its role in society as a catalyst for economic justice and as a destination for first-generation college students. I'm one of those students. I graduated from Wayne State. Wayne State was recently recognized as number one university in the state of Michigan in social mobility for its student body, number one in the state of Michigan. Before I close today, I would like to introduce two other members of the Board of Governors who are here with us today, Governor Marilyn Kelly, you want to stand in the first row, and Governor Anil Kumar. Thank you very much. And as I close, I just want to thank you for being here today. I hope you learned something new during today's program that will inspire you to join the effort to make our city and our nation the better places they can become. Thank you.
Virginia Kleist, Dean, Mike Illich, School of Business.
Good morning. Good morning and welcome to the Illich School of Business. I want to thank our wonderful Detroit School of Arts drumline, the Detroit Academy of Arts and Sciences show choir, and invite them to be Illich students, particularly the little ones, any day that we'll welcome them. About 70 years ago, in 1954 in Montgomery, Alabama, Rosa Parks refused to go and sit in the back of the bus for a white man. Martin Luther King Jr. was named president of the Montgomery Improvement Association, and black people in Montgomery boycotted the bus system for a year right after that happened. One of the more interesting stories about Mike Illich, the namesake of this building, that we are celebrating in today, is that when Rosa Parks was robbed in her home here in Detroit, Mr. Illich stepped up and had her moved to a nicer home and paid her bills for several years until her death in 2005, anonymously. He never spoke about it, no one knew about it until about 2014. I am honored to welcome you here today to celebrate Martin Luther King Jr. Day and to share that story about Rosa Parks and Mike Ilitch. The theme of today's tribute to Martin Luther King Jr. is economic freedom through social justice. A business school cannot be purely about capitalism, all about making money, and that's it. Here at the Ilitch School of Business, we are about these larger themes of capitalism, but the concept of social benefit through business. Our faculty conduct research about the increased valuations of companies that pursue socially beneficial policies as compared to those companies that do not. Those companies that pursue socially beneficial policies tend to have higher valuations of their corporate. We also have faculty who explore the benefits of ride-sharing applications for communities that do not have good access to public transportation, showing the benefits of technology to those underserved communities. Our supply chain faculty routinely explore third-tier suppliers to make sure that they, our students learn about how to make sure that they are not using child labor for offshore suppliers. We want to provide our students with an infrastructure in their education about how we can all contribute to thriving businesses, but in ways that are socially advantageous, provide pathways for all to enter the corridors of power and business. We take great pride in our teaching model and how we support our students here. We have a robustly diverse and multicultural student population, which we celebrate. We think it sets us apart as a model for learning. At the Ilitch School of Business, you will have a student on your right who is African American, a student on your left who is of Middle Eastern descent, and most of your peers will be first-generation college students. Nearly all students have jobs working outside of this building while attending school, graduate or undergraduate. Our students are gritty, they know time management, and they are in no way entitled. Our graduates know how to roll up their sleeves and get a job done because that is what they're doing here. To support our students of color, multicultural and first-generation students, we have a Multicultural Professional Readiness Education Scholars Program, or MPREP. These students are paired with mentors, wrapped in a bubble of caring and support, and given a foundation for professional and academic success, while celebrating everyone's authentic experiences. They are also placed in internships and jobs that make the most of their excellent Ilitch School educations. In fact, a word to our wonderful sponsors today. Thank you for supporting the MPREP Scholars Program in the past, and we welcome you to do so in the future with mentors, financial support, internships, and placement. Maybe some of you are thinking about an advanced degree. Please consider the Ilitch School because you'll get a great return on your investment for your tuition dollars. Thank you for joining with us this morning for this wonderful tribute to the Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. And I want you to know that we at the Ilitch School of Business are particularly committed and acting on the promise of the theme for this morning, economic freedom through social justice. Thank you.
The Detroit School of Arts Lady Achievers Vocal Ensemble will perform Hold On under the direction of Ashley Paul.
Keep your head on the plow and hold on, just hold on. No run, no run, let me come in. The doors are twisting and the wind has been. Keep your head on the plow, hold on, just hold on. No said you've done lost your train. Well, you can't plow straight.
Keep on looking back.
Just keep your head on the plow, hold on. Just hold on,
brother, hold on.
Yes, brother, hold on. Yes, hold on. Keep your head on the plow. Hold on, just hold on.
you want to get to heaven, let me tell you how. Just keep your head on the plow. Keep your head on the plow. Hold on, just hold on. If that plow stays in your head, let you straight into the promised land. Just keep your head on the plow. Hold on, just hold on.
Sister, hold on.
Yes, brother.
Sister, hold on.
Yes, hold on. Keep your head on the plow. Hold on, just hold on.
Mary Ann, my God and Jane, and everything's fair, just my Jesus' name.
Keep your head on the plow. Hold on, just hold on.
Keep on climbing, and don't you stop. Hold on, your
just hold on. Keep your head on the plow. Hold on, just hold on.
Sister, hold on.
Yes, brother.
Sister, hold on.
Yes, hold on. Keep your head on the plow. Hold on, just hold on.
Sister, hold on.
Yes, brother.
Sister, hold on.
Yes, hold on. Keep your head on the plow.
Mackenzie Bisdorf presents an excerpt from Dr. King's acceptance speech on the occasion of winning the Nobel Peace Prize in 1964.
I believe that even amid today's mortar bursts and whining bullets, there is still hope for a brighter tomorrow. I believe that wounded justice lying prostrate on the blood-flowing streets of our nations can be lifted from its dust of shame to reign supreme among the children of men. I have the audacity to believe that peoples everywhere can receive 3 meals a day for their bodies, culture and education for their minds, dignity, equality, and freedom for their spirits. I believe that what self-centered men have torn down, men other-centered can build up. I still believe that one day mankind will bow before the altars of God and be crowned triumphant over war and bloodshed, and nonviolent redemptive good will proclaim the rule of the land. And the lion and the lamb shall lie down together, and every man shall lie under his own vine and fig tree, and none shall be afraid. I still believe that we shall overcome. This faith can give us courage to face the uncertainties of the future. It will give our tired feet new strength as we continue our forward stride toward the city of freedom.
Mm-hmm. Today's presenting the Dream sponsor is Amazon. Please welcome Ian Conyers, Head of Community Affairs, Amazon.
Well, thank you all for being here today. It's an honor to bring greetings on behalf of the 30,000 Amazonians that call Michigan home, many right here in the city of Detroit. Over the past year, it's been an honor to donate over $2 million to 70 Detroit-based organizations focused on wellness, recreation, and upskilling across the city of Detroit. In thinking about Dr. King, I thought it important to reflect a bit on a recent trip I took down to the National Civil Rights Museum at the Lorraine Motel in Memphis, Tennessee, where Dr. King gave his life. And I think it's incredibly important for the next generation to understand that he did not die of natural causes, that his life was taken at 39 years old. When we're thinking about economic justice, when we're thinking about political justice, and I want to say quickly, it is such an honor to sit next to Randy Williams, because that economic justice is what he stood up for. The last campaigns of his life were in Chicago, focusing on redlining and housing, improving the economics behind us being left out of housing. The last campaign in Memphis was with the sanitation workers and making sure that they were given decent wages. And it's not lost on me that my late great uncle John Conyers Jr., a double warrior, by the way, right here at Wayne State University, got the moniker that led his entire career, jobs, justice, and peace, from his friend, Dr. Martin Luther King, separated by only 4 or 5 months in age, marching together throughout our entire nation, working to make sure that folks had not only political justice, but economic justice, that final barrier we continue to march towards today. And I'll end just thinking with another giant of that era, Reverend Adam Clayton Powell Jr., who said, most specifically, we want dignity. And dignity means we don't want anything more than you, but we're not going to accept anything less than you. Thank you so much.
The Dr. Arthur L. Johnson Community Leadership Awards are presented by Rocket Companies. Please welcome Kamari Yoel, Chief Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Officer and Chief Learning Officer, Rocket Companies.
Good morning. I want to first say thank you to Stacy Clayton for inviting us to partner with Wayne State on this very special event. We are proud to be a presenting sponsor for the Dr. Arthur L. Johnson Community Leadership Award. We know that Dr. Arthur L. Johnson was committed to civil rights and economic justice. At Rocket Companies, we believe that everyone should have the ability and access to pursue their dreams of home ownership. As a result, we are focused on closing the home ownership gap, as well as supporting those who live in our communities in a meaningful way. With programs such as the Rocket Wealth Accelerator, we will serve residents and clients in Detroit, Cleveland, Milwaukee, and Atlanta. For those that don't know, we're investing $2 million into that, which will provide those folks in those communities with coaches who will work with them to improve their ability to meet their needs, build their credit, and grow generational wealth. Also, we believe that digital access is a basic right. Therefore, we've invested over nearly $3 million to bridge the digital divide by working with community partners to ensure every home in Detroit has access to the internet. And then lastly, we also ensure that we provide equitable access to our team members through education and development. And we do that through the Rock Academy, which provides 100% tuition assistance to those team members to achieve their goals of education, whether that is a bachelor's degree, master's degree, or a certificate. So with that being said, I am elated to be here with you today, but I'm also proud to be a Detroit native and a warrior. and have the opportunity every single day to work within rocket companies to impact the communities in which we serve. Thank you.
Stacy Clayton, Director of Community Affairs, Wayne State University.
Thank you. Thank you, Kamari and Rocket Companies. Good morning, everyone. It is so good to be here. Good morning. Thank you, and we're so pleased that you have joined us for the Wayne State University tribute to the life and legacy of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. This annual signature event was the idea of the late Dr. Arthur L. Johnson, who served as a senior vice president at Wayne State University and was a classmate of Dr. King's at Morehouse College. In his memoir, Race and Remembrance, Dr. Johnson stated, "I wanted to make sure that Wayne State's Martin Luther King Jr. Memorial Program will be first rate and attract not only students, but the community at large. We remain committed to that vision of an exceptional and community-embracing celebration of Dr. King's life and legacy, and we hope that you're enjoying today's program." Prior to his time at Wayne State and during his time at Wayne State, Dr. Johnson was a remarkable civil rights and community leader, educator, and administrator. The Dr. Arthur L. Johnson Community Leadership Awards honor an organization and an individual exemplifying Dr. Johnson's commitment to community and making a positive difference in Detroit and beyond. We are grateful to Rocket Companies as a presenting sponsor of these awards. Please watch this video honoring Dr. Johnson, followed by the award recipients. Thank you.
Dr. Arthur L. Johnson was a civil rights pioneer, human rights advocate, educator, scholar, and ultimately a champion of justice. He retired as senior vice president of Wayne State University in 1995 after serving 23 years in various high-ranking positions. Embodying a fierce but quiet courage, Dr. Johnson was perhaps greater known as a freedom fighter in the battle to end racial segregation and discrimination. In neighborhoods, businesses, restaurants, hospitals, banks, and other institutions throughout Detroit. In 1948, he graduated from Morehouse College alongside his classmate and close friend, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. And like Dr. King, Art Johnson grew into an extraordinary individual whose legacy both endows and inspires all our efforts to create unity and a better city. After being recruited to Detroit in 1950 by the NAACP to serve as the National Executive Secretary, Dr. Johnson served in this capacity from 1950 to 1964. Longtime friend Judge Damon J. Keith said, "Art rose from poverty to prominence largely on the strength of his intellect, integrity, determination, and compassion for all people. He was a man of absolute integrity, loyalty, and commitment to this city and community." The Arthur L. Johnson Community Leadership Awards recognizes individuals and organizations that embody the same passion and desires that Dr. Johnson lived by, to invest in the community and in the lives of others. He will be forever remembered as a champion of justice.
Established in 2001, the Dennis W. Archer Scholarship Fund has awarded nearly $2 million in scholarships that have been provided to minority students at Wayne State University and Western Michigan University. For the past 20 years, more than 400 Archer Scholar Awards have been granted. In addition to his scholarship fund, the Dennis W. Archer Community Development Fund was created to support charitable activities that improve Detroit neighborhoods and the lives of their residents. Since 2003, the Community Development Fund has provided more than $1.3 million in support to local organizations. The Dennis W. Archer Scholarship and Community Development Funds are receiving the Dr. Arthur L. Johnson Community Leadership Award in recognition of their providing long-term support for minority youth and the residents of Detroit.
I was born in Detroit, and when I was 5 years old, I moved to Cassopolis, Michigan. Cassopolis, Michigan is about 187 miles from Detroit. Its population is 1,200. My dad had a third grade education, but he had a PhD in life and how to treat people, how to work with people. And my mom had a high school diploma. The one thing that both my mom and dad made very clear to me is that I was going to go to college. I started working at the age of 8, and I worked my way through high school, worked my way through undergraduate school, and worked my way through law school. I started at Wayne, and I wound up graduating at Western Michigan University. And at Western Michigan University, I worked when I was on campus. I worked at one of the dorms. I worked the evening meal because that was the one I could eat the most, and it would help me a great deal. And then I think I made about $1.25 an hour, but it put some money in my pocket. So I understood the value of education. But if you have to work 15, 20 hours a week, in addition to trying to do a good job in school, it just meant that these students would have a difficult time getting the kind of grades that they wanted, and therefore might slow them down or might discourage them, etc. And so I thought I would start a scholarship fund. And I started it in 2001, and we've had over 404 outstanding young people who are now working in their area of interest. They've graduated, they're contributing members to the community and society in which they live. And over since 2001, this year, we will have given over $1 million to Wayne State University and $1 million to Western Michigan University. And they interview and recommend students to my foundation, which is now run out of the Community Foundation for Southeastern Michigan. And I've enjoyed doing that because it's helped our community and it's made a difference.
Good morning again. Mayor Archer has reached the point in his life where he does not spend winters here in Detroit. He is a snowbird. So he asked me as a former member of the Archer administration to accept the award on his behalf. He thanks Wayne State University for recognizing him, and he said it's his honor to ensure that students in Detroit have an opportunity to attend a wonderful university such as Wayne State and Western Michigan as well. Thank you.
Dr. Earlene J. Hall is a driven educator who recognized the potential in young people who had been written off by society. About 30 years ago, she asked her principal for a 3-year commitment to work with the lowest functioning students entering the sixth grade. After that group, all of Dr. Hall's students were at the top of the school's list. The daughter of Detroit still finds time to support her community by volunteering with SDM Squared Project Education, a community-based nonprofit organization. Earlene Hall is receiving the Dr. Arthur L. Johnson Community Leadership Award for her steadfast advocacy for excellence and equity in urban education and her unwavering commitment to the community.
I'm passionate about teaching and education because it's just a part of my essence. It's who I am. I believe that anything that you do, if you don't do it with passion, then you're not doing it as effectively as it could be done. And I think that when it comes to teaching and learning, understanding that connection between the two and how it works, and that's exactly what we need people now to do as far as educating our children in urban school districts. And it's important that they have people who have passion for what they do and not just do it for a job. It's a part of who I am. I grew up in Jeffries Projects, and during that time, back during the 50s and the 60s, life was a whole lot different then. I think I was very fortunate to come across a group of teachers that serviced that elementary school I went to that had that passion for learning, who had that efficacy in their heart when it came to the children being able to not just learn, but learn in a way that they would want to continue learning and be lifelong learners. When I think about how my students were positively impacted, to use their own words, I just kept it real with them. It was important to me that they learn. It was important to me that they became the very best that they could be. And I wouldn't just keep going to make sure that we covered a certain amount of materials. It was important to me that learning took place. It was also important to me that they felt it was important for learning to take place. So my role was not just teaching them academic content, it was teaching them about themselves, teaching them life skills that would help them be successful in what they did by first believing in themselves. I think being an educator laid the foundation for who I am as a community advocate. I think that realizing that the children that come into our schools leave a community that has needs and desires. If those needs aren't addressed, a child can't come to school and do his very best if he's hungry. And so if that community has a need for food, if that community has a need for medical resources, if that community has a need for employment, all those kinds of things, then that's going to support that child and then support their learning. I think that being a teacher taught me a lot of things, and that's that learning comes in a lot of different places, and that there are some things that when they're present, learning is better. If I were still teaching today, and I wanted to give a message to my students now, I would say to them, believe in yourself. Believe in yourself and believe in those that you surround yourself with. Surround yourself to the best of your ability with those things that are moving forward. Look for things to get rough, because that's what life is. Things get rough, but you got to keep on moving. You got to keep on moving because you can do it. You know, you can do anything on this earth that any other human being has done. You can do the same thing if you believe in you. You can do anything any other human being has done.
Ethan Martin presents an excerpt of Dr. King's speech, A Time to Break Silence, delivered April 4, 1967, to Riverside Church in New York City.
Increasingly by choice or by accident, this is the role our nation has taken, the role of those who make peaceful revolution impossible by refusing to give up the privilege and the pleasures that come from the immense profits of overseas investments. I am convinced that if we are to get on the right side of the world revolution, we as a nation must undergo a radical revolution of values. We must rapidly begin the shift from a thing-oriented society to a person-oriented society. When machines and computers, profit motives and property rights are considered more important than people, the giant triplets of racism, extreme materialism, and militarism are incapable of being conquered. A true revolution of values will soon cause us to question the fairness and justice in many of our past and present policies. But one day, we must come to see that the whole Jericho Road must be transformed so that men and women will not be constantly beaten and robbed as they make their journey on life's highway. True compassion is more than flinging a simple coin at a beggar. It comes to see that an edifice which produces beggars needs restructuring. A true revolution of values will soon look uneasily at the glaring contrast of wealth and poverty.
Detroit's own and finalist on the national television show, The Voice, Zania Alake.
Hello, everyone. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was a man of peace and love. So I present to you peace and love.
It's love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, not just for some, but for everyone. Lord, we don't need another mountain. There are mountains and hillsides enough to climb. There are oceans and rivers enough to cross, enough to last till the end of time. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just. All we need is love. All we need is love.
Thank you.
Welcome, Patrick Lindsay, Vice President of Government Affairs and Community Affairs, Wayne State University.
Let's give Ms. Alake another hand. You know, that was supposed to actually be a duet, but I had a wardrobe malfunction with my green sparkly suit, so she decided she could handle it herself. Thank God. Well, your program say Portia Robeson should be doing this part, but she unfortunately was unable to be here, but this is a special part also in our program. Dr. King said, a genuine leader is not a searcher for consensus, but a molder of consensus. Last year, we presented our first Warrior Strong Distinguished Service Award to the former president of the Detroit City Council, Brenda Jones, who's here with us today. This year, we're going to honor another Brenda. Recently retired and native Detroiter, Congresswoman Brenda L. Lawrence retired at the end of 2022 after 30 years of service. She was elected to the U.S. House of Representatives in November of 2014. She was elected to serve as freshman whip and appointed senior whip. Prior to Brenda leaving Congress, she was a ranking member of the House Oversight and Government Reform Committee's Subcommittee on the Interior. She also was a member of the House Committee on Small Business and served on the Subcommittee for Agriculture, Energy, and Trade and the Subcommittee on Contracting and Workforce. Before she began her political career, Congresswoman Lawrence had a notable 30-year career at the U.S. Postal Service, where she rose through the ranks from the position of letter carrier to human resources executive. Prior to Ms. Brenda going to Washington, D.C., her local political career was equally extensive, including her election as mayor of the city of Southfield in November of 2001, where she became the city's first African-American mayor and the first woman to serve in that post. Prior to her 14-year tenure as mayor, she served on the Southfield City Council, where she was elected president in 1999. She also served on the Southfield Public School Board and in the capacity of secretary, vice president, and president of that body. All of us know Congresswoman Lawrence as a staunch fighter, a supporter of Detroit, and certainly one who has stood by Wayne State University. We received a $6 million grant for rare earth research reuse here at Wayne State due to that support she's provided. Congresswoman Lawrence sponsored the first Wayne State in Washington, D.C. Day. This standing room only event in it showcased Wayne State University's Office of Women's Health and highlighted the work that we do in helping to address maternal and infant mortality issues. Congresswoman Lawrence fought in Congress for funding for Wayne State's perinatology research branch, the only branch of the National Institutes of Health outside of Bethesda, Maryland. We've had a great run with that branch, which is now going back to D.C., but without Congresswoman Lawrence's support, it would not have given this community 20 years of vital service. And lastly, over a dozen of her colleagues from the Congressional Black Caucus held a day-long event here on our campus listening to issues that deal with black women, those women who had been incarcerated, women who had been in jail, and women who had barriers to progress in the workplace and in society. And so it's for these reasons, and because she's just a phenomenal sister, and I'm honored to call her also a friend, that we are pleased to honor Congresswoman Brenda L. Lawrence with our Warrior Strong Leadership Service Award.
The Honorable Brenda L. Lawrence, retired United States Congresswoman.
Thank you. I want to say thank you to Wayne State. This is such an honor for me. To the Board of Governors who are here, thank you for your work and everyone who attended today. 30 years of my life, I served as an elected official, and I like to reduce that and to lift that by saying I was a public servant. I never once forgot that the trust of the people being placed in me was such a strong obligation to the future of not only my community, but for my people. See, I've been around the block a little bit. So I've lived through 9/11, and ladies and gentlemen, I was on the floor. I lived through January the 6th. I witnessed the awakening of a country through Black Lives Matter and the George Floyd movement. It was something amazing to be a public servant and to work and live through that. I also witnessed the first Black president and was able to serve with him and shake his hand and fly on Air Force One with him. I've shaken the hands of many presidents during my time as an elected official. I sat on the floor with John Lewis, getting into some good trouble, where we sat on the floor and shut down the U.S. House of Representatives to protest and bring awareness to gun violence in our country. I did it all as a fighter, and that's what a warrior is. See, I pray that my legacy will reflect that I never forgot that I was a servant of the people, and I never forgot, as Martin Luther King advised us constantly, to have hope and responsibility. And if I can leave anything with someone, the responsibility for legacy. And that means everything you do fortifies the next generation. See, I want my legacy to be that many can stand on my shoulders as those before me stood on my shoulders. And I went to work every day for 30 years, believing in something that we are one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And like Martin Luther King, I will never walk away from that. Because if we all are not at the table, somebody needs to be standing up, fighting, and making sure our voices are being heard. Thank you so much, and God bless you.
Hannah D. Hunt, presenting an excerpt from The Other America, Dr. King's 1968 lecture to students at Grosse Pointe High School.
In a sense, this was a struggle for decency. Black people could not go to a lunch counter in so many instances to get a hamburger or a cup of coffee. They could not make use of public accommodations. Public transportation was segregated, and often they had to sit in the back. And within transportation, they often had to stand over empty seats because they were reserved for whites only. They did not have the right to vote in so many areas of the South, and the struggle was to deal with these problems. And certainly they were difficult problems. They were humiliating conditions. By the thousands, people protested these conditions. They made it clear that it was ultimately more honorable to accept jail cell sentences than to accept segregation and humiliation. By the thousands, students and adults decided to sit in at segregated lunch counters to protest conditions there. When they were sitting at those lunch counters, they were in reality standing up for the best in the American dream. Many things were gained as a result of these years of struggle.
In 1964, the Civil Rights Bill came into being after the Birmingham movement, which did a great deal to subpoena a large segment of the nation to appear before the judgment seat of morality on the whole question of civil rights. After the Selma movement in 1965, we were able to get a voting rights bill. And all of these things represented strides. But we must see that the struggle today is much more difficult. It's more difficult today because we are struggling now for genuine equality. It's much easier to integrate a lunch counter than it is to guarantee a livable income and a good, solid job. It's much easier to guarantee the right to vote than it is to guarantee the right to live in sanitary, decent housing conditions. It is much easier to integrate a public park than it is to make genuine, quality, integrated education a reality. And so today, we are struggling for something that says that we demand genuine equality.
Reverend V. Lonnie Peake, Jr., distinguished Wayne State University alumnus and founder of the Wayne State University Black Student Organization in 1967.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Whoa, I don't know if that many people here. The house is packed. Anyway, I want to thank Wayne State University, and particularly Stacy Clayton, who was one of the jewels in the crown of Wayne State University, for inviting me to be a part of this auspicious occasion. I want to acknowledge my friend, Dr. Roy. We're sorry to see you go, but we're happy for you, because you've earned the right to move on. So I just want to thank you for that. Just a couple of points. How did I get here? Yes, it's true that back in 1967, I started the Association of Black Students. The 67, 68, 69, that was a particular historical era in the country. Urban rebellions and riots were taking place throughout our country. So the summer of that particular time, Detroit had its own rebellion. Well, switching tracks here. So in September of 1967, I'm entering Wayne State University as a full-time student working on my master's degree in social work. So the first day on campus, I walk into McGregor Hall, and I noticed it was like hundreds of people. And I says, whoa, what is this? Well, I didn't really understand that I had walked into a hornet's nest. Because what happened, Wayne State University was planning to do an urban symposium, but the community had not been included in the process. So they were protesting the exclusion of community folks. So here I am, just lollygagging around, walking into McGregor, seeing all of these people, and not understanding that I was in the midst of a hornet's nest. So the reporters were interviewing various people, and they turned to this one fella by the name of Frank Joyce. I happened to know him. And it says, who represents the black students? And Frank says, he does. And this is a true story. So they turned around, they came up to me with the mics, asked me for my name, and they say, who do you represent? I says, the Association of Black Students. That's how the organization was born. Wasn't no big research grant or nothing like that. So the Lord will use you, okay. Through the Lord's guidance, I was able to build an organization. And today we have the Black Student Union, which is an offshoot of the Association of Black Students. So 67, 68, and 69, we became the premier organization in the city of Detroit because at the drop of a hat, I could get 500 students. And sometimes I had to do that for protesting reasons. Well, sometimes in life, being at the right place and the right time presents you an opportunity, and it's how you manage that opportunity and how you use that opportunity to move forward based upon the goals that the Lord wants you to establish. Now, there's one particular goal that I'm really proud of, and that is I wanted the organization to be more than just, you know, hellraisers. I wanted us to do stuff. So one day, the President William Keast, good dude, he and I had a very good relationship. I understood that he was the president. He understood that I was head of the student association. So I said, Dr. Keast, you know what, man? I says, on the West Coast, there are a number of colleges and universities that are starting to create and be involved in Black Studies programs. I would like to take a delegation of students to go out to California, take a look at it, and come back. He said, okay. He said, bring me a budget, which I did do. Well, five of us went out to California. We spent a week going up and down the coast, came back to Dr. Keast, gave him a blueprint of what we thought could be a good Black Studies program. Well, over the course of years, that particular document has morphed into what we have now as the Africana Studies Department. So I felt very good that we were able to do something in a manner that something concrete is in position. So it's good to be able to raise your hand and your fist relative to protest, but then what are you going to do? So I thought that was a good effort, and I've always felt that the Lord used us to establish that. Now, as a close, my relationship with Martin Luther King, interesting. In 2011, I got a call from the Martin Luther King Memorial Foundation in Washington, D.C. They were in the process of putting together a plan to build a monument on the Tidal Basin. So they called and they asked, would I come to Washington and discuss with them our involvement in this particular effort? So my wife Eunice and I, oh, that's Eunice right there, my wife Eunice and I. Please, yes, yes, keep it happy. Anyway, my wife Eunice and I went to Washington, they talked. We agreed, and we spent about 6-7 years crisscrossing across the country relating to churches, cities, helping raise $120 million for the foundation itself. So I say that with the caveat is, how did my name get on their lips? Well, Dr. Charles Adams, who was on the board, they were discussing who they wanted to hire, and he said, no, the person you really need to get is Lonnie Peak. And they came, we worked it out, and so Eunice and I crisscrossed the country 5-6 years raising money for the monument. This is the point here. You never know behind closed doors who's going to put your name on the table or who's going to take your name off the table. And it's about the character that you pursue. There's certain things in life you can't go out to get, but will come to you based upon your character and your ability to produce. So, with all of that, I'm very honored to be a Wayne State University graduate, and I look forward to continuing to work with Wayne State University, because we have a mission to accomplish, and that is to educate. So the Lord has blessed us to be the cross paths of being able to be involved in the continuing evolution of Wayne State University. So right here, see this picture right here? I'm right over here. I'm right here. My mother and a friend of ours drove down for that. I'll never forget that. When you got to Washington, D.C., in the Washington Monument, it was quiet. You heard Mahalia Jackson singing, but you knew that you were in a part of history. So I just wanted to give that as a caveat. Now, let's do this. No, it's about me. Let's talk about the man of the day, the man of the hour. Randy D. Williams is the founder and president of Talley and Twine, the largest black-owned luxury watch company. With a love for watches and his simple sketches, the Albany State University alum launched a renowned line of watches and accessories for men and women. Randy and Talley and Twine have been featured in the New York Times, CBS News, Black Enterprise, Essence, Men's Health, Cosmopolitan, Ebony, and many other national and international media outlets. When Randy designed the Talley and Twine watches, he did away with most of the numbers, leaving each watch face with the lone 7. The number 7 represents a completion and serves as a reminder to start what you start, you finish. For Randy, Talley and Twine is the culmination of decades of hard work, determination, and trial and error, because everything does not work first. But if you commit it to it, you stay to work out the kinks. Well, he's been honored, and after receiving a bachelor's degree from Albany State University, where he was active in several organizations, including Delta Mu Delta, National Business Honor Society, and Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity, Randy worked in sales and embarked upon several business ventures in real estate and e-commerce. In 2010, he self-published his first book, Be a King, to inspire young men lives of leadership for purpose. His second book, 7 Questions Every Young Leader Must Experience, he also published. His books and his personal experience allows him to talk to college students throughout the land. Now, not only is Randy a business leader, he's also a commercial real estate investor, and he's also devoted his life to philanthropy and community service. He was named Hampton Roads Black Chamber Entrepreneur of the Year and has earned numerous awards. He's also a founding member of Visions for Change, a giving circle, an endowed fund at the Hampton Roads Community Foundation that provides support for charity causes in the black community. Most recently, Talley and Twine established a $10,000 business scholarship at Albany State University. Randy lives in Portsmouth, Virginia, with his wife, Deanne, and their daughter, Nyla. Thank you.
Please welcome our keynote speaker, Mr. Randy D. Williams, founder and president of Talley and Twine Watch Company.
I'm so honored to be here today. But before I get started, I'll turn this one off because I don't need that. Can we give a hand to all of the talent that we've seen today? All of the speakers, the musicians. One word comes to mind. I've only been in Detroit for a short period of time. One word just kept coming to my mind while I was sitting there, and that's excellence. There is such a spirit of excellence here, not only in Detroit, but really at Wayne State University. And I hope that you all understand the types of people that you have here. The true gems, they're jewels in their community. Everybody that I've met has been so sincere, loving, appreciative, and willing to help me in any way that I needed it. Don't take that for granted, because I've been a lot of places and that's not the case. And I just want to say thank you all for the hospitality. Everybody that I've met, I feel like I'm at home. I'm definitely coming back. It will not be in the winter, but I will be back. And so again, I want to say I appreciate that. I want to talk about part of Dr. King's legacy that's often overlooked. If you were like me, and if your school system was similar to ours, I grew up in rural Georgia, what you learned about Dr. King was the fact that he had a dream and he was nonviolent. And it stopped there. It wasn't until I became an adult that I sought out on my own path to learn about Dr. King, to learn about what he stood for. And I realized that Dr. King was not a weak man. Dr. King was not a passive man. In fact, he was one of the most courageous leaders that we've ever had. You know, a person who chooses restraint when they have the ability to choose violence is stronger than the person who reacts emotionally. And what I've learned about Dr. King is that his legacy is multi-layered. A child prodigy, but also someone that was not only talking about civil and social justice, but economic justice. The Poor People's Campaign, which you may have heard about, is one of the things that I think we should talk more about. And what that is saying that America has a responsibility to us to compensate us for what we've done for this country. I remember watching an interview a few years ago, and Dr. King said something that really struck me. He said, the next time we go to Washington, we're going to get our check. And the panel last night talked about that and how important it is to push lawmakers, to push those decision makers in society, to push us closer to economic justice, because we do need that portion. But what we're going to talk about today is, I think, three keys to economic empowerment that we can do together, that we can empower ourselves to do, that I think are nuggets from his legacy and things that I've used in my life as well. I'm from a really small town called Camilla, Georgia, and I grew up just wanting to make something out of myself. Our biggest employer, y'all can probably relate to this, was a chicken plant. It's a chicken factory. We didn't make tires, but we made chicken. And it's just understood that when you graduate college, you go and work at the chicken plant, right? My whole childhood from middle school to high school was trying to avoid that chicken plant. I didn't want to accept that fate. I didn't want to be pigeonholed into doing one thing because everybody else was doing it, because that's what was expected of me. And so I started out on this entrepreneurial journey. I set up a lemonade stand. Nobody came. I went to the basketball court and I sold pages out of Slam magazine to the people playing basketball for 25 cents. And I even got suspended from school for selling candy at school as well. And through that trial and error, man, you really learn about yourself, but you also learn about people. And today we're going to talk about the human aspect of what it means to be economically empowered. And before I get started, I want to let you know how I know I'm in the right place today is when I checked into my hotel at the MGM Grand. Right after she gave me my key card, I looked down on the floor, and there was a wad of cash at my foot. Now, we were in the casino, but I didn't partake. It was only $3. But that is my note to myself to say, hey, Randy, you're in the right place at the right time. So we'll see what happens with that $3 after we leave here today. Hey, the first key, I believe, that we can learn from Dr. King's legacy about economic empowerment is collaboration. Here's a quote. We can all get more together than we can apart. And this is the way we gain power. Power is the ability to achieve purpose. Power is the ability to effect change. And we need power. And I'm reflecting on that statement and considering the lens of collaboration. I spoke to a business mentor of mine a few years ago. This was actually when I was first starting out with Talley and Twine. I was having lunch with him, and the first question I asked him was, what is your biggest challenge in business? And at this time, he owns three multi-million dollar Chick-fil-A's. What's your biggest challenge in business? He said, without hesitation, people. And you can think about, even in your personal lives, what's your biggest relationship challenge? People, that guy you met that you probably shouldn't have gave your number to. And what is your biggest challenge at work? Most people are not unhappy because of what they do. They're unhappy because of the people that are surrounding them, that they work with, right? So I began to reflect on who was around Dr. King. Who did he confide in? Who was it that he practiced his speeches with? Who did he get ideas from? Who did he plan and strategize with? And all of these great names start coming to mind. Ralph Abernathy, Fred Shuttlesworth, Rosa Parks, Ella Baker, Coretta Scott King herself, and John Lewis. We start thinking about all these names, and somebody mentioned it earlier. I believe it was the educator, how important that inner circle is and the people that you surround yourself with. And I can only imagine what those conversations were like.
Those people also became individually great contributors in their community, individual peacemakers and trendsetters in their own communities and families and legends in their own right. So the first key to economic empowerment is collaboration. We've got to get the right people in the room and surround ourselves with the right people to make these good decisions. But also, the second part to that collaboration is group economics. Now, we can simplify this by really saying this. There's power in our dollars. So if we don't have anything else, one thing that we as African Americans do in the US is we consume. We consume to the tune of about $1 trillion a year is our spending power. So if no law gets changed, we have the power to control what happens with our dollar. And it can be used in two ways. The first way, support black businesses like Talley and Twine Watch Company. Instead of choosing a big brand, you can choose a black brand. It's very simple to do. The second thing we can do that we saw illustrated with, through Dr. King, is we can take our dollars away. So those companies who don't support us, who don't speak to us, who support unjust laws, who support political candidates that don't have our best interests, we can take our dollars away from them, and that is our power and true economic power. We can show that in force. We've seen this played out in Dr. King's life. Whether it be through unionizing, sit-ins, boycotts, somebody mentioned the Montgomery bus boycott, we saw the effectiveness of that. So that's the B portion. So the first key to economic empowerment is collaboration. The second key is competence. I'll give you a quote from Dr. King. Intelligence plus character, as someone mentioned earlier, that is the goal of true education. Intelligence plus character. When I'm often interviewed about Talley and Twine, people ask me, well, how did you know how to make a watch? And the answer is I didn't. It's a learning process, and I'm still learning every day. And what I realize is that, especially for the students in the room, you need to understand that we live in the best time in history to start a business. We live in the information age where nothing is out of reach. No piece of information is beyond you. The veil has been torn down, and you can get any piece of information that you need to further your career and your business life. And I think we take that for granted, and we use it for things like social media, watching me personally recipe videos on TikTok. But we can really use that as a tool to really open the floodgates of not only information, but also that collaboration that I spoke to about earlier. But the key is you can learn from everything that you have access to. So in my course of entrepreneurship and achieving to the status of what Talley and Twine is today, I was telling the crowd last night that I failed at business for about 10 years. So this is through trial and error. And in that moment, you not only learn about business, you learn a lot about yourself. But there is really no progress, there is no competence that will be achieved without that failure. And as I was telling a student earlier today, you won't know until you get out there and try it. You got to get out there and try it. You've got to learn to fall, scrape your knee, get up, and do it again. One of Dr. King's biggest failures was actually 30 minutes from my hometown of Camilla, Georgia, and it was in Albany, Georgia. Some of you might not know this, but Dr. King, just as he went to Chicago, somebody mentioned earlier, went to Albany, Georgia to fight segregation, one of the most racially segregated towns in Georgia. And he was hardly able to achieve anything. You know, he left with his head hanging because the racist structure in power was so organized, the people were so apathetic that he wasn't able to get much done. But without those failures, like in Albany, Georgia, we don't get the success of the Montgomery bus boycott. We have to learn how to take those failures and synthesize that information. One of the things I also learned about Dr. King that's really important is that he was a lifelong learner and a voracious reader. He studied books on law. He studied books on social justice, philosophy, and revolutions. He learned from Gandhi the philosophy that he ultimately adopted, which was peaceful resistance. And it's through those things that he learned that he was able to synthesize and create his own philosophy on life that we know as the nonviolent movement. But we can never stop learning, because when you do that, you end the growth and development of whatever your personal civil rights fight might be. Dr. King had to also learn the law. Without understanding a law and understanding that it's unjust, you can't fight it. And by understanding the law, he was able to hold a mirror to the United States government and say, hey, look at your hypocrisy. These are the things you said you stood for, but this is what you're showing me how much we're worth. You said I'm 3/4 of a man. This is not what your Constitution says. And even though we had the right to vote, we still had to fight voter intimidation. But it's only through understanding that law that you can understand what it means to truly advance and further the purposes of what you're trying to do. There is no substitute for competence. So that's the other thing I learned from Dr. King. Never stop learning. And the third and the final key to economic empowerment is consistency. This isn't the sexiest one, all right? Most of you, in fact, the diet that you started this month, you're probably already off of it. I went to dinner with some people last night. I won't call anybody's name. I'm not gonna make eye contact. But consistency is the most overlooked aspect of success, because it's boring, right? All you have to do is just keep making baby steps, keep making progress. When I was writing my book, I made sure to write something every day. You know, sometimes it was a sentence, sometimes it was a paragraph, sometimes it was a page. But without that progress and that forward movement, you'll get stalled out. So consistency is often overlooked. Dr. King said it like this: human progress is neither automatic nor inevitable. Every step toward the goal of justice requires sacrifice, suffering, and struggle. The tireless exertions and passionate concern of dedicated individuals. Success is neither automatic nor inevitable. I'll give you a quick story about when I started Talley and Twine. My goal was to be in Macy's. And I looked at that Red Star logo every holiday, watched the parade, said, I gotta be in there. And so I tried for 3 years to get into their retail program. Applied, denied, applied, denied, applied, denied, until I realized that the true power of Talley and Twine came from my own community. So what we're gonna do is ignore the big retailer, and we're gonna focus on selling to the people who want to hear our products, who wanna see our products, who care that we even exist, and we're gonna focus on them. So that's what we did for the next few years. And last year, guess who came calling? Not only Macy's with the purchase order, but also Nordstrom with the purchase order. Thank you. And to me, that represents the importance of keeping your head down. We've never sought out headlines. We haven't had a PR person that was trying to get us on television. We've always focused on keeping our head down, making good products, and serving our customers well. If you're in business, I'll give you a quick nugget, a jewel right now that you can use. Customer service as a whole is dead. So if your business acknowledges people in a way that they haven't been spoken to, you're already ahead of the competition. We've gotten to the point now where we don't even expect good service. So when somebody gives it to us, it's wow, you know, it's a shock. So that's a nugget for you. Customer service is really important. Somebody mentioned the Montgomery bus boycott earlier, and the fact that it lasted a year, 382 days to be exact. But take a deeper look at that. What did it take for a full year for a group of poor people in Montgomery, Alabama, to not take the bus? During this time, 70% of the bus riders were African American. So for a year, they didn't use it. So what did they do? Taxi drivers matched the fare of the bus, so the black taxi drivers drove them to work. Most of the people continued to walk to work instead of taking the bus. They carpooled. They figured out a way to do it, and they didn't get tired after month 3, 4, 5, 6. They kept going until they achieve their aims and their purposes. And that's why I say consistency is the most important aspect of success, especially economic development. I also found out that even though we hear about the I Have a Dream speech, and that's the one that they tout, Dr. King himself gave over 2,500 speeches. Most of us don't know 2,500 words. Dr. King gave over 2,500 speeches in his lifetime to all kind of groups, and these are just the ones we have documented. We don't know about the smaller interactions when he went into people's homes. He was consistent in what he does. And so when he gets the microphone at the March on Washington, this is not his first time speaking to an audience. It's your first time hearing it. And they say that, you know, successful people are like in an incubator. You know, it takes 10 years to make an overnight success. Well, by the time you hear about him, oh, he's an overnight success. He came out of nowhere. No, actually, this person has been doing this for quite a while. So real change is made through consistency. So to recap, first thing we need if we're going to be economically empowered is collaboration. The second thing we need for economic empowerment is competence. We've got to understand the war that we're fighting and use those tools to our advantage. And the third and final thing is consistency. All great things happen through consistency. Thank you. I should probably take this since my face is on it.
Collaboration, competence, consistency. I had it written down, so I was going to cheat if I didn't remember. But we want to thank our keynote speaker for helping not only to deliver inspiring words, but himself an example of those three qualities that he quoted, not only in his business endeavor, but as a father, a husband, as a man who supports his community, we like to thank our keynote speaker, Randy D. Williams. And I'm going to present to you, Randy, if you can come back up. This has certainly been a great morning of reflection, of celebration, of remembrance of the life and legacy of the late, great Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who was a father, a husband, a man, a Baptist preacher, an alpha man, Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated. But just someone all of us can still draw from. Never let his dream be minimized. Never let his words or his life be marginalized. And so on behalf of Wayne State University, I'd like to thank all of you for being here today, certainly members of our Board of Governors, all of those fellow members of the President's Cabinet who are here today, the staff and the students who are here in the audience. We appreciate all of you for being here. We certainly want to again thank our keynote speaker as well as our sponsors who help make this program possible. You see them all on your screen. Amazon, our presenting sponsor, Rocket Companies, who's been with us for years, Stellantis, aka Chrysler Corporation. Seal, Verizon, Sennheiser, Comcast, Ford Motor Company, hello Stephanie, Heritage, MCA, Focused on What Matters, Queen Lillian, Walker Miller, Little Caesars, Bridge Detroit, WDET, and there is one other one there. MGM Grand, Siebert Williams, and Shank. It's too small on that screen, so I couldn't see it. But all of our sponsors, let's give them all a hand. As Stacy reminded us, Dr. Johnson said this should be a first-rate program and the community should be involved. We're grateful for our youth, our students who were able to be participants today. We hear that there is Little Caesars Pizza awaiting for them at their schools. We want to thank the Wayne State team who helped make this possible, including my team, the Division of Government and Community Affairs, under the direction, as you all have heard before, Stacy Clayton, our Director of Community Affairs. There are a lot of student and staff volunteers here who have given of their time and energy, not only today, but last night and beyond. I want to thank all of them, our partners at University Television, who every year do an excellent job producing film of this event, our special events team. We also want to thank Mario Cheney, Chief Tony Holt, and Pamela William, who works under the direction of Dean Kleist here at the Mike Gillis School of Business. And thank you again, Dean, for allowing us to be in this fabulous facility. In closing, today's program was taped, and it will be shown on Monday, King Day, at 10 a.m. at go.wayne.edu/MLK2023. I think I said that correctly. go.wayne.edu/MLK2023. Additionally, on Monday, WDET 101.9 FM will be broadcasting Dr. King's historic and iconic I Have a Dream speech in its entirety during the Detroit Today program at 9 a.m. and again at 7 o'clock p.m. It has been my delight and pleasure to be with you today. Thank you again, Dr. Wilson, for all you do. Thank you, Congresswoman Lawrence, for being with us and to our community. Dr. Johnson recipient, Dr. Hale, thank you. By the way, she taught at the junior high school that I hail from, Joy Junior High, on the east side of the city of Detroit. So just a little love. God bless you. God keep you. Have a blessed day.